I think the best place to start is 20 years, right? Drive-by truckers have been about 20 years. Is that, yeah. Is my math right?
That's yeah. About exactly, almost exactly right.
June 10th, 1996.
And 11 studio records, is that right?
Yeah.
The way I count them? I counted them, I just didn't know
I think
if I was
so.
Doing it right.
Yeah, I think that's about right. Don't ask me what songs are on any of them.
Do you know any band that you love that has 11 studio albums?
They're decent records?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I think a singer's might, right?
Right.
Yeah.
But is there a band?
Oh, I can't name of? One.
I mean, the Rolling Stones do.
That doesn't mean, because I can't name one doesn't mean they don't exist.
Yeah. But American bands, I guess. I mean, the Rolling Stones most certainly do, but I wouldn't vouch for all of them.
Well, I mean, they're probably jazz artists that have had 20 or more.
Well, there's country singers for
yeah,
sure,
yeah.
too.
Yeah, they release a lot of records, but no, I don't know.
I'm talking about American rock band.
No, yeah. Yeah.
So I guess in that way, the title of the record's apropos. You're the American band.
I figure we've seen about as much of America as probably any band on earth. I mean, we're way over 2,000 shows. I don't know where exactly we are, but we're well over 2,000 shows, and so we're about to hit state number 47 on this next run because mm-hmm. we've never played South Dakota, yeah. and that'll leave us North Dakota, Hawaii, and Alaska. And I've been to them mm-hmm. except for Alaska. I haven't been to Alaska yet, but we'll hit them yet.
That's cool.
But I mean, most presidents have not been to that many states. You know, I think Obama's like made a point that he's going to hit.
We don't want the job.
No.
It looks like it sucks.
It looks like it sucks.
Yeah,
it looks like
definitely.
It sucks. That said, 20 years. I mean, you seem to have this lineup seems really.
Yeah,
like
we're almost 5 years on this. Yeah, it's. Yeah. It's by far our longest period of just everything being going right, you know. I mean, by years and years, actually.
Yeah.
But it's been fun, you know. It's been a lot of fun. It's been the best time I've had the whole time I've been doing this. We've been together 31 years in August, and the last few years have been by far my favorites.
Yeah, it's been wonderful.
Cool. Very cool. Well, the record is fantastic. The record is obviously, we'll get into each song, but it's different. I mean, I looked at the cover and right away it's different. It's a
right.
photograph rather than a Wes Fried drawing. Mostly it's, to me, it's very timely. And I'm curious.
Unfortunately.
Unfortunately. So when you say unfortunately, do you think the events that have happened the number of years made you write this record? Or did you say, I guess, is it a chicken or the egg thing?
Yeah. Yeah, it is. I mean, the particular 20 years, you know, not just the number, mm-hmm. but the specific 20 years that we've been a band, I think has everything to do with what we're writing about and trying to comment on this, you know. There's almost nothing that's happening now that you can't go back to about 1996, give or take, and this is where this got started, or 1980,
yeah.
right,
or 1968, or 1964, or 1954. Those were all pivotal points.
Do you feel like? I mean, I know what I feel like, which is sort of. You know, you've decided to be an artist, you decided to be a musician, and this is what you can do. Like, right. This is one of the things you can do anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, we kind of made it a point to, you know, we've always been a political band, and we've always had that aspect of what we do, and it's always been a big part of how we grew up, you know, loving The Clash and bands that did that. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, I always kind of felt like that's something they did, but we always kind of had our different way of, you know, we would tell a story that would illustrate a point, or we hoped would illustrate a point, without necessarily quite being as direct about it. And, you know, and there just came a point where it's like, you know, gloves are off, man. I just don't, it's like, I don't want to you know, I don't feel like telling a story right now. I just want to get it out there and what we're thinking about.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I feel like for me, it's like, you know, you used to not talk about politics at a dinner party. And now I feel like I don't want to invite those people to my party.
Yeah.
Know?
Yeah. I mean, you probably still shouldn't talk about it there, but, you know, using your platform, that's not a dinner party. That's my house.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And if you're here, you're going to hear it.
Right. That's great. I think, you know, my take on it is I totally agree. The stories were always political, but this is, to me, when I listen to it the most.
And it is still personal. You know, it is personal. I mean, you know, Guns of Umpqua, you know, about when we moved to Oregon last summer, we spent 3 weeks driving cross country. Mm-hmm. And the night we got to Denver was we were checking into the hotel and there were TVs on everywhere, and it was what had just happened in Charleston, South Carolina, the massacre in Charleston.
Yeah,
and
that had a pretty major impact.
I had my kids, and I'm like, it's like, all right, I got to know what's going on because this is terrible, and I've got to know what's up. But I don't want my kids. I got to get my kids in the room, situated, and then I'm gonna come downstairs, and I'm gonna see, you know, what the fuck's going on. And so we watched that. I watched that, and then had the next day, you know, try to be cheerful driving through the Rocky Mountains with my kids in the car, and while it's just eating at me. And the last night we spent on that drive, the night before we got to Portland, we stopped in is it Blacksburg, the town where Umpqua College is.
Oh.
And we spent the night at that little college town at a little motel. You know, it was like 3.5 hours from home, and we were, it's like perfect timing, let's stop for the night and get up and drive in fresh. And so, you know, so, and then the day that all happened, the shooting in Umpqua, I woke up and it was a beautiful day. And in retrospect, I think about how 9/11 was such a beautiful September day. I mean, the most bluest sky you've ever seen. It was that kind of a day. And I'm sitting out on my porch eating coffee, you know, drinking my coffee, and you know, kind of looking over the news, and that comes up. That had just happened. I'm like, God, that's that town we just spent the night in, you know, and it's a beautiful day, you know, and there's birds chirping, and thinking, God, you know, who wakes up on a morning like this and goes and does that? You know, it's like, what the fuck is going on? And, you know, so it's still personal, you know. I mean, every song on this record is very personal.
Yeah. I've seen all my life, but I started paying more attention in recent years to people that I know on a personal level, from being where I'm from and coming from where I've come from, and my experiences. People who are well-meaning, decent people, but have these values and these beliefs and these things that are important to them that I don't necessarily agree with. But to have these profiteers constantly exploiting those values and those beliefs and what they consider
sacred
to be their way of life.
Yeah.
Until then it gets to the point where these profiteers are telling them what their way of life is in order to exploit it. And it was such a vicious cycle. And I know most of these people are not the people you see. They're not the people that the cameras are normally pointed at. Mm-hmm. They're decent people.
Sure.
They're just being taken advantage of. They're being exploited. And it just, you know, I wanted to try to comment on these things from the point of view of someone who comes from that.
Yeah.
And understands why having those emotional buttons pushed makes them react the way they do.
Yeah. That's probably a good time to jump into the songs. And the first song, which is, has a Mike Cooley song let off? Dirty South, was that the last time you had a...
He let off the last record, too.
He did.
Shit Shots, yeah.
Shit Shots was the first, that's the single, but the also the... So, Ramon Cassiano.
Yeah.
How did you learn of that story, I guess?
I never had a clue that story existed. I was kind of intrigued. I've been intrigued by the whole you know, since the KKK took over the NRA thing for a long, long time. It sounds like a Ramones song. But
it's half a one.
Specific one. But I was watching how these right-wing anti-government militia type, you know, gun culture guys would go down to the border on the weekends and pretend to be Border Patrol, and I thought it was silly, you know. I was kind of laughing at it. But then I was, what is it with these people in the Mexican border? Why are they obsessed with this? And it was later, you know, that Ebola and ISIS, that they're coming across the Mexican border, and they, whatever you're scared of at the moment is coming across the Mexican border. We have two, you know, but it's always that one. And I ended up stumbling across this, and you know, it was just jaw-dropping irony. It didn't mean anything. I don't even know if it's connected, but come to find out, the guy who orchestrated the NRA becoming the NRA as we know it today, not the old NRA. They were a very different organization. They were always a little kooky, but they were harmless.
Sure.
They were harmless.
Michael
kooks.
Moore was a member of the NRA.
Oh, a lot of people were. Everybody's dear old grandpappy was. Then that's part of why it works, you know. It's this storied organization that has this long, wholesome history that could be co-opted into this, you know, right-wing white supremacist gun cult, basically. But, you know, I lo and behold, the guy who orchestrated that killed a Mexican kid when he was just a teenager himself, became a crooked border agent that exploited Operation Wetback, which was the Eisenhower administration's official title for this deportation thing that several months ago, Donald Trump was talking about being this great idea that the Eisenhower administration had. And this was way after I'd written the song. It just, it's the gift that keeps on giving, you know? And
that's why I said, unfortunately, timely.
Yeah.
You know, unfortunately, timely. You
know, right.
We'd rather it not be.
But I try to get to the whole white supremacist nature of the whole gun thing. It's got nothing to do with guns and rights. It's got everything to do with money and power and politics. And
well, the last line of the song, which I'm going to get wrong, but it's something like Ramon Cassiano isn't dead enough, or you know, he's dead isn't. Because it's the whole idea of him almost.
Well, oh yeah. Well, if they were to ever win this war, it would all be over for them.
Right. Yeah. What would they do?
Oh yeah. Right. It's how do you keep this going? It's the fight. You know.
Well, that's why now we declare war on emotions. We declare war on terror instead of a specific group, so that we can, you know, because those pesky Russians, they went bankrupt, and all of a sudden we didn't have a Cold War anymore.
Yeah.
So now let's declare war on an emotion, you know, on terror and whatever next, you know.
Darkened flags on the cusp of dawn. It made me, when I heard that song, I immediately thought of the New York Times piece you wrote.
Right. I wrote it the same day that I wrote the first draft for that. And, you know, I was talking a minute ago about on that drive, Charleston happened when we were in Denver. And by the time we got to California, or it was actually when we were in California on the drive, I got a call from someone with the New York Times inquiring if I'd be interested in writing an op-ed for the Sunday magazine. And I'm like, well, I would really like to, but I'm driving with my family cross country. I got to get us to Portland. And so they're like, well, when you get there, write it and submit it. And we can't make a promise, but if we like it, we'll run it. But the sooner we get it, the better chance of us running it. So I got them there on Tuesday, and then on Wednesday and Thursday, I basically sequestered myself at a coffee shop right down the street and wrote all day. Mm-hmm. And Thursday night, when I finished what I considered the first draft that I was going to send to them, I got home and I was just sitting there blowing off steam, and I was picking a guitar and I wrote that song. So it was kind of basically all that stuff that was still in my mind, kind of in a different form.
Yeah. What did there's this thing that comes up in that song, which comes up again, that I noticed is baggage.
Right.
I thought that's almost like, in my mind, it's an alternate title for the record, or certainly a subplot. You say baggage a few times, and it's the title.
Yeah, and I didn't
track.
Even realize that until we were mixing the record. But and it's like, oh, I was putting together the lyrics for
that
the
happens,
text.
Too.
Yeah, yeah. That happens a lot. Yeah. It happens between us, you mm-hmm. know,
yeah.
and particularly the last two records. It's been happening a lot.
It seems like some, it is. You know, it's the baggage that we all carry with us.
Right.
From not just ourselves, but our families, and it seems like
sure.
that keeps coming up. Or
yeah. We were looking for a title for the record. That was, I didn't think
yeah,
of that
I think
one.
You got a better one.
Yeah, we did. Totally did.